गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। सो गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। एट द आउटसेट आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक डॉक्टर रजनी एंड ऑल द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स फॉर हैविंग सच अ वंडरफुल सेशन एंड देन यू नो हैविंग मी एज पार्ट ऑफ इट। And thank you, Rajni, for all the great words. I don't think I'm really worth it or not. And it's really an honor to be, you know, chaired by two such eminent senior people from your undergraduate and postgraduate college. It is very easy for somebody who speaks at the last in a workshop, if you have excellent speakers speaking before you, because most of the common topics have already been covered. So I can straight away jump into the clinical features, EEG. And so we'll try to make it as interactive as possible. And I think most of the common theme related to this topic has been covered. So we'll start now. Yeah. Okay. So the outline of the presentation would be, we'll briefly define what is genetic generalized epilepsy, what are the clinical presentations in genetic generalized epilepsy, some prototype EEGs, a brief summary, and then we would go to the other topic, that is periodic complexes. We'll talk about the descriptors, how we describe periodic complexes, and some prototype EEGs. We'll cover the basic things here, and then when we have workshop in the afternoon, we'll go into these things in a bit more detail. Next slide. Next. So if you look at the definition, it is a generalized semiology of presumed genetic origin. So we'll not go into the genetic details. So can you go to the first slide? This is what, this is going forward and this is going backward, right? But it is moving forward now.
This is forward. No. This one is forward, this one is backward.
Now, presumed genetic origin, genetic generalized epilepsy. So they are all generalized semiology. And we'll just discuss the prototype, the common ones, which includes generalized tonic-clonic seizures, absent seizures, and myoclonic seizures. The focus of this presentation will be to cover the common ones, which are childhood absence, juvenile absence, primary generalized epilepsy, and juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. And we'll just look into the clinical features. We'll have some video descriptors also to look at the variants amongst these entities. How can we differentiate on the basis of clinical features? And then we'll also look at some of the prototype EEGs and how activation procedures actually help us in, you know, differentiating between these various forms of EEG. Okay, so we'll start with absence epilepsy, primarily seen between 4 to 10 years of age. The peak is at 6 to 7 years. There is typical versus atypical and simple versus complex. So when we talk of atypical absences, so atypical absences are primarily seen in those epilepsy syndromes which Dr. Prashant has already covered. So same thing, epilepsy, which are catastrophic epilepsies. So would be associated with multiple semiologies, will have a bad outcome. EEG-wise also, they are different. So our focus will be more on typical absence seizure. But within typical absence seizure, we have something called simple versus complex. So moving on to the simple one. So when we describe childhood absence epilepsy, they're described under four headings. So there is an impaired consciousness, that is a blank look, which is universal, presenting all forms. Motor phenomena, autonomic phenomena, and behavioral phenomena. These are primarily seen with the complex absence seizures. So simple and complex are for typical absence seizures, not for atypical. So when we look at motor, what are the kind of things that we can see? Eyelid blinking, nystagmus, tonic posture of the arms and trunk, head nodding. These are the things that can be seen. When we talk of autonomic, we can see things like pupillo dilatation, pallor, flushing, sweating, salivation, urination. When we're talking of behavioral, we can see automatism, which are commonly described with absence seizures. Perseverative, that is, it will continue during the time, like it will start with an activity. There will be a blank look with something happening. The child will continue to do that but we'll come back again to reality, but we'll forget what has happened in that time. So the child will continue playing or handling a toy. The other is de novo. So it'll be something new, like a lip smacking, chewing, grimacing, rubbing of face and hands, fumbling with clothes. So these things will get clearer as we'll start seeing the videos. So moving on to the classic EEG finding. So this is what you will see in a typical absent seizure. On hyperventilation, you will see a 3 hertz spike in wave. Arjun, where is the pointer? Okay, so the laptop cannot come in. So if you see those, so these are the 3 hertz spike in wave. So these will be frontally predominant. So this is classically seen with childhood absent seizure. Moving on to the complex absent syndromes, this we need to know because these are the ones which will have the complex features. If you remember, we had typical absent seizures, simple, complex, and incomplex. These are the common syndromes that you should be aware of. So the one is Jivon syndrome. Clinically, it's a triad of eyelid myoclonia, photosensitivity, and eye closure sensitivity. So that means the moment the eyes are closed, the seizure will get precipitated. Other semiologies will also be seen, like absences, GTCs, focal seizures, mainly of occipital onset. And the EEG findings will be spike and polyspike wave discharges, along with 3 hertz generalized discharges, which will be accentuated again by, as I said, eye closure, photic stimulation, hyperventilation, and sleep. So just remember, when we are talking of these generalized epilepsies, the activation procedure, that is photic stimulation and hyperventilation, plays a big role in actually differentiating them. One is the clinical semiology, and the other is the activation procedures, which help us in differentiating them. Then we have Tassinelli syndrome, which is again an axial myoclonia followed by tonic contraction of bilateral upper limbs, and the typical feature of absence, that is the behavioral errors. Rarely, you will also see other variants like GTCS, atonic, and tonic seizures. So again, generalized polyspike discharges, 3 to 4 hertz spike angle discharges, again accentuated by hyperventilation and photic stimulation. Just, this is an observation which has been seen over the years and now part of most of the textbooks. With Jivon syndrome, you will see more with photic stimulation, less chances to see with hyperventilation. With Tassinari, you will see more with hyperventilation and less chances to see with photic stimulation, but this is not sacrosanct, but this is what you will usually see. So this is, as you can see, what is this? Eye blink artifact. And you will see this generalized discharge. Right? So this is seen in Jivon syndrome. As I said, eye blink artifact is there. The moment there is an eye blink, you see an area of 3 hertz spiking wave discharge. So moving on to the other common one, juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. So the commonest idiopathic generalized epilepsy, as it was previously called, now known as genetic generalized epilepsies, 25% and 10% of all epilepsies. Onset is around 12 to 18 years. There is a female preponderance. And classically, you will see early morning myoclonic jerks, which precede the development of GTCS and absences by 6 to 12 months. So many times, if a patient of this age has come to you with generalized tonic-clonic seizures, please ask history of early morning myoclonus, that whether the child was dropping objects a year back, since last 1 year, does he drop objects early in the morning? Because that will give you some hint, or going blank in the class, because the GTCS may actually be succeeded by these ones, which may be missed by the parents. Classical EEG findings are 4 to 6 hertz spike and polyspike activity seen in 60%, accentuated by photic stimulation, and 3 hertz spike and wave activity. So this is an EEG snapshot. Don't worry, because we'll see some continuous EEGs also now. Some videos also in which I will try to get feedback from you whether whatever I have said, you're able to identify that on the video and the EEG. And the second part is we'll also go through them when we're in the workshop. So this is the classic EEG snapshot of a juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. As you can see, this is photic stimulation at 10 hertz. And you can see this burst of generalized spike polyspike wave activity around 4 to 6 hertz. So absence around 3 hertz with hyperventilation, JME around 4 to 6 hertz with photic stimulation, and that also high frequency photic stimulation. So now, before going to this EEG, I'll just minimize and show the three videos. So we'll start with video one. We'll go to these EEGs later. First, we'll see the videos and you'll have to tell me. Anybody can volunteer. I would prefer that the DMs don't volunteer, because many of these patients you would have seen, and otherwise also you tend to see these patients more frequently. So let us have from other participants, and in case we need, then you can. So we'll start with video one. So, till the time he sets it up, let us just revise it once. Absent seizure. childhood absence, classic, 3 hertz, spike in width. Juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, 4 to 6 hertz, polyspike with photic stimulation. Childhood absence with hyperventilation. Jeevons, eyelid blinking or photic stimulation, 3 hertz spike, polyspike with activity. Tarsinary, so specific clinical semiology, and then on hyperventilation, you will see what is the characteristic EEG pattern. So what is this? This is a child in whom while performing EEG, we are asking one of the activation procedures. So many times, now see what has happened. Can we just start from the beginning once more? Just want them to observe. So this is how we ask the child to actually hyperventilate. If you ask them to breathe heavily, it may become difficult. This is something which is easier for them to do, to blow into a piece of paper. So till this time, I think it is simple. You're seeing somebody is hyperventilating, then we'll go to the EEG part. So now see what has happened. So he gets behavioral arrest. He stopped doing what he was doing. Immediately you see 3 hertz spike and wave discharges with hyperventilation. Now I want you to see and let me know what is happening. You saw what was happening in between, and you'll have to tell me what was that. Still continuing to happen. So why are you calling it automatism? So there's fumbling of clothes, non-specific movements. He had covered his face also, if you see, in the beginning. And so there must be some movement happening, and then he started fumbling with his clothes, picking his clothes. So these are classical automatisms seen with absence seizure. Okay. So I think you can see now the behavioral arrest part is gone, the EEG is clearing up, and see what is happening. So he's again started with. So it was just a brief period of behavioral arrest, and then he continued what he was doing. So this is classically a clinical manifestation of childhood absence epilepsy and an EEG correlate. So moving on to the next video. The official video, so you should be able to. Anybody can tell me what is happening? Rajini, you are sitting behind. Yeah. So you can see Rajini sitting behind in the video, but. What is happening in front is more important. Yeah. So this is classically how a Jeevan syndrome child would, you know, present. The moment you ask the child to close his eyes, you will see this eyelid myoclonia and behavioral arrest. And just remember one more thing that just before we play this video. When we're talking about Jeevan syndrome and Tarsinary syndrome, so they have associated myoclonia. So when we look at their EEGs, as has been highlighted since morning, try to identify polyspikes. If in hyperventilation you are seeing polyspikes, then you are dealing with complex absence epilepsy syndromes. Otherwise, mostly you will be seeing spike in wave that is typically seen with classical childhood absence epilepsy. Video 3 now. You will tell me what is happening in video 3. Maximize camera. Play the video again. So we have talked about it. So if you observe carefully, you will see what is happening in this child. So what kind of myoclonus is this? Yes, this is Tarsinary. So again, axial myoclonus giving rise to 3 hertz spike in wave. Now these EEGs, I would, you know, make you differentiate these EEGs once we see them in the afternoon in the workshop, how a tarsinary EEG will be slightly different from a G1 EEG, how the hyperventilation will be different in them, that we'll cover in the workshop. So now you can go back to the presentation. Thank you. So I think you could identify the common way of how these children will present. So a simple hyperventilation procedure in the OPD, you can look at a childhood absence epilepsy, you can see a G1 syndrome, and you can also see tarsinary syndrome. Now moving on to this. This is typical posterior dominant alpha rhythm, awake state. So what I have done is I have taken the important snapshots from a continuous EEG and tried to show you the CGF parts. Can I start? So now moving on to the next one. So what is happening? It is still continuing, and you can see that there is a lot of eye blinking happening, but it's not precipitating anything. What is this? You can see some occipital predominant delta activity started with embedded spikes. Can you see? And this is with, as you see the green mark in the beginning, hyperventilation has started. Still continuing. And now you see, once the hyperventilation has happened to a certain extent, a full-fledged, you can see a generalized spiking wave discharge. Now, just to clarify it further, what I have done is, you'll have to revise what Dr. Goswami told you in the morning. So now see, look at the sensitivity. The sensitivity that was 70 at that time, the blue box in the extreme corner is now 200, so that you can see it better. So you can see that there is a spike and wave activity, some polyspikes, but mostly spike and wave activity which are frontally predominant, and some of them are also seen equally in the occipital area. So this is classically what you will see in a hyperventilation. You will see a frontally predominant 3 hertz spike and wave activity, maybe some embedded polyspikes. And when the hyperventilation starts, you may see some intermittent rhythmic delta activity which starts from the occipital area. Now we move to photic simulation. See what is happening in photic. You can again see with 10 hertz, there is a runoff activity happening. It is 70 microvolt. We move to 200 microvolt. And now what is there? Again, what is the frequency? Can anybody tell me? So what is the frequency that we see in juvenile myoclonic epilepsy? Are you seeing here? 3 hertz with photic simulation. So nothing with eyelid opening. 3 hertz spike and wave with hyperventilation. Some embedded polyspikes. 3 hertz spike and wave again with photic stimulation, continuing with higher frequencies. You can again see, you see properly in the frontal area, it's primarily spike and wave. Very few embedded spikes, polyspikes. Otherwise, it's mostly single. There are a few polyspikes there. Okay. What is this? Nothing on eye blinking. Hyperventilation precipitating 3 hertz spike and wave with some embedded polyspikes. Photic stimulation also bringing 3 hertz spiking wave with some embedded polyspike. So which variant is this? This is juvenile absence. So just remember, childhood absence epilepsy will primarily show 3 hertz spiking wave with hyperventilation. And your photic stimulation will most of the times won't show anything or won't accentuate the discharge is already there. Juvenile absence, usually the frequency of myoclonic jerks or generalized tonic-clonic seizures are more with juvenile absence compared to childhood absence. So you have more chances of picking up myoclonic jerks, and your photic stimulation or hyperventilation, both will have 3 hertz spike and wave activity with some embedded polyspikes because this is juvenile absence. We will see some EEGs in the workshop. This thing will get clearer, but these are the concepts which you need to remember because these activation procedures along with the clinical findings are going to help you differentiating these entities. Okay, now moving on to EEG 2. Again, a posterior dominant alpha rhythm, awake state. Hyperventilation has started. You see there is a green line which is showing your hyperventilation has started. What is there on hyperventilation? Can anybody tell me? Sorry. The hyperventilation is actually uneventful. So I've kept it in one snapshot only. Nothing on usual awake state, posterior dominant alpha rhythm. Hyperventilation was more or less like this, which showed posterior dominant alpha rhythm. Then you have this photic stimulation at 10 hertz. Can you see this yellow mark? Even photic 10 hertz. So there is something. So we need to understand it better. What is there? What is the amplitude? What is the frequency? Which is the predominant electrode? So from 70 sensitivity, we move to sensitivity of 100. Now, can anybody tell me what is that that we see? See here, it will be better. See this one at 12 hertz. See this one. What do you see? There are around 4 hertz to 6 hertz varying spike, polyspike, followed by slow wave activity with photic stimulation. Nothing on normal awake, hyperventilation, nothing. 4 to 6 hertz spike, polyspike. This is predominant polyspike, spike, slow wave activity. With high frequency photic stimulation, 10 to 12 hertz. What is this? JM. So this is how, using activation procedures, you can differentiate. We started with CAE, then we went to JAE, and now we are in JME. Now look at this. What do you see? There is some activity, but preceding the activity, what do you see? Yes, just see the eye blinks. And the moment there are eye blinks, you see this burst of generalized activity. Yes. You see here, this is again sensitivity of 70 microvolts. Sensitivity of 150 microvolts. Now what do you see? 3 to 4 hertz, spike, polyspike, generalized activity precipitated by eye blinking. What is this? Gibbon syndrome. Okay. So again, hyperventilation has started. It's more or less slightly accentuated, but you can see that before the burst, there are preceding eye blinks, which is leading to this burst. There are some eye blinks again leading to the burst. Photic stimulation, you see this burst getting accentuated. I slightly decrease the sensitivity to show you. What do you see? Again, around 3 to 4 hertz spike, polyspike wave activity with photic stimulation. But how will you differentiate this from JE? So what is the difference between juvenile absence epilepsy and Gibbon syndrome? Yes. So the eye closure sensitivity won't be there with juvenile absence epilepsy. Your hyperventilation and photic stimulation may be a bit similar in both. Both showing accentuation of activity, both showing generalized spike as well as embedded polyspike. But the eye closure sensitivity will differentiate these two. And of course, the clinical features. Just to summarize, whatever clinically we have seen and whatever the EEG findings are. When we are talking about classical absence epilepsy, a routine EEG would show generalized discharges. Hyperventilation would show 3 hertz spiking wave discharges. And this would be accentuation of the absence, the generalized discharges that are seen on routine EEG. We'll again go through some of these prototype EEGs in the workshop. Gibbon syndrome, 3 hertz polyspike, spike and wave discharge on eyelid closure. 3 hertz spike, polyspike and wave discharge and hyperventilation, and same on photic stimulation. Tarsinari syndrome. Generalized 3 to 4 hertz spike and polyspike wave discharges. Why spike and polyspike with Gibbon and Tarsinari? Because along with absence, there is a component of myoclonia in both. Okay. Again, with hyperventilation as well as photic stimulation, you see these generalized 3 to 4 hertz spike, polyspike wave discharges. Juvenile absence, generalized discharges. 3 hertz spike and wave discharges with hyperventilation as well as photic stimulation. Juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, very rarely you will see anything with hyperventilation. 4 to 6 hertz spike, polyspike and wave discharges. And primary or idiopathic generalized epilepsy, otherwise non-specified. What does it mean? That it is not fitting into any of these entities. How will they be? It come with generalized tonic-clonic seizures, generalized discharges on EEG. And what is interesting in this would be that even during hyperventilation, photic stimulation, you will see discharges, but they will not be accentuated compared to what will be seen otherwise without these activation procedures. So the EEGs that we have not covered here, we'll be covering them in the workshop. Okay. Right. So if more or less we have understood what are these genetic generalized epilepsies, now I'll move into the concept of periodic complexes. If you have any queries, you can ask, or we'll move on to the periodic complexes. You done? Okay. So when we're talking of periodic complexes, just remember that what are periodic complexes? They'll come and go. So they will be recurring at a specific interval with some specific morphology, specific frequency. So how they have been, you know, so the International League Against Epilepsy and the American Society of Electrophysiology, Clinical Electrophysiology, they have come out in 2021 with some guidelines. So what I have done is I have tried to, you know, use those guidelines only. We'll see one EEG here, and in the workshop also we'll see some other prototype periodic discharge EEGs, and we'll try to describe them using the recent descriptors only. So what is periodic? It's a relatively uniform wave pattern recurring at an interval which varies by less than 50% in greater than 50% of pairs. So what does it mean? Here is a periodic discharge, another periodic discharge. So the interval between these two, whatever it is, and the interval between the next two. So like this, in more than 50% of these pairs, they will vary, the duration will vary with less than 50%. Got it? So this is, then the term that is used is regular. So then we call it regular. And has to recur for at least 6 cycles. Call it periodic discharge. First, they have to fulfill that criteria of less than 50% and more than 50%, and have to recur 6 times to call it a periodic discharge. Now, something is discharged, something is burst. So how are they two different? So just remember that for our clinical purpose and for our diagnostic purpose, many of these things will overlap. But for research purpose, or if we have, you know, for academic reasons, if we have to describe. So what is a discharge? The duration has to be less than 0.5 seconds. If it is more than 0.5 seconds, it cannot be more than 3 phases. 3 phases ka kya matlab hota hai? So you will have, it cannot cross baseline more than twice. So what does it mean? So you have a wave. I'll just show you when we go to an EEG, you'll understand. So there is a baseline. Wave will have an upslope. It will be a crest, a downslope, and then it will cross the baseline. So this crossing cannot happen more than twice. So if you think about it, 3 phases, 2 crossings. So crossings are always 1 less than the number of phases. Okay. So bursts more than 0.5 seconds, but more than 3 phases. So that is how we differentiate. When we are calling periodic discharges, either they are less than 0.5 seconds. If they are more than 0.5 seconds, then they cannot have more than 3 phases. If they are more than 3 phases, then they are periodic bursts. Okay. Now there is one more entity, which is called rhythmic delta activity. So there will be sinusoidal wave pattern of 6 cycles, and the frequency will vary. And again, intercycle, each cycle, the duration will not vary by more than 50% in greater than 50% of subsequent pairs. Spike wave, sharp wave complexes. The one is spike wave, sharp wave activity that we see. What are complexes? Again, for 6 cycles with no interval in between. So these are the descriptors that we need to know when we are describing periodic discharges. What is periodic? It's clear. What is discharge? It is clear. When do we call periodic discharge? When do we call periodic bursts? It is clear. Rhythmic delta activity, again, something which can come in periods. And then spike wave, sharp wave complexes should at least last for 6 cycles with no intervening normalcy in between, right? So these are the descriptors. So these are the morphology descriptors. Next, we come to the topography descriptors. So again, you have generalized periodic discharges, lateralized periodic discharges, bilateral independent discharges. So how do we, you know that? Simply understanding, generalized would be bilaterally symmetric and synchronous. They may have some predominance. That is, it may be frontally predominant, it may be occipitally predominant, it may be centrally predominant, it may not be predominant at all. All the, you know, electrodes may be discharging, firing in a similar way. So how do we know? So if the amplitude of one particular group of electrodes is 50% more than the rest. Symmetric and synchronous. Symmetric means that the difference in amplitude in either waves, in either hemisphere, will not be there. Synchronous, they'll be more or less starting at the same period of time. So this is bilaterally symmetric and synchronous and may have some predominance. I'm trying to make it simple. If you go into the descriptors, there'll be multiple other terms as well. So for at this point of time, before we go into the workshop, just understand that generalized will be bilaterally symmetric and synchronous, and it will be, it may have some voltage predominance. Okay. Lateralized. It will be unilateral. So what is this? When we are saying lateralized, it means it is coming from one hemisphere, right? So either one hemisphere or another hemisphere, but this one hemisphere will be predominant in more than 80% of the record. Is it clear? So when we say consistently for periodic discharges, it is for more than 80%. So unilateral or bilateral, see, asymmetric and asynchronous. Why? Because either in terms of amplitude or in terms of when it starts, one hemisphere will always be leading if you're going to call it lateralized periodic discharge. I hope there's no confusion in this. Okay. Now we have bilateral independent. So what is bilateral independent? Bilateral asynchronous and independent complexes occurring simultaneously in both hemispheres. What does it mean? They will occur simultaneously, but one will start slightly behind the other, or their morphology will be different. So they're bilaterally independent, but starting simultaneously. So bilaterally independent periodic discharges. If not simultaneous, suppose one is starting at certain point of time, the other is starting at some other point of time. So then independent lateralized periodic discharges from both sides. So when we are saying bilateral, they have to be simultaneous. If they are at different time points, they are unilateral LPDs of either hemisphere. Okay. Unilateral independent, same hemisphere. It has started firing, but from similar area, it has started firing, but what is happening is it is asynchronous. That means, suppose you have the left hemisphere. So FP1, F3, and F7 are firing simultaneously. So that is one discharge area. There is another one, which is also more or less starting at the same time, but there will be some asynchrony and the morphology will be different. So they are independent, unilateral, lateralized periodic discharges. Okay? Okay. This is, what is this? Can anybody tell me? So this is what typical periodic discharge would look like. But why are, this is the same EEG. Why are they looking different? So which one has a higher paper speed? Why? Why are you saying the left one has a higher paper speed? You're right. So you're correct. So you don't think that you're wrong. But why are you saying it has a higher paper speed? So it is actually the speed of the paper. So always remember, it is the speed of the paper, not the speed of the epoch. So if the paper speed is faster, it will cover lesser epoch. So that is why you have to increase the paper speed to cover more epochs. You have to decrease the paper speed to cover more epochs. Is it clear? So this is what, more or less, you can see. They're starting simultaneously, both the hemispheres, they're bilaterally symmetrical as well as synchronous. So what is it? This is a generalized periodic discharge. So during this presentation, we'll just stop at generalized periodic discharge. In the workshop, we'll see both lateralized discharges as well as bilateral independent discharges, and we'll see how they're different. So at this point of time, just understand, because from either hemisphere, it is symmetric, synchronous, starting together, bilaterally symmetric. So this is how a generalized periodic discharge would look like. They have to occur at least 6 cycles. The interval between them, each subsequent pairs, should not vary by more than 50% in less than 50%. And paper speed, when you decrease, you cover more epochs. Okay, so here if you see, what is the paper speed? 30 millimeter. See, what is the paper speed here? 6 millimeter. That is able to cover more epochs. So what is the significance of these discharges? So in adults, these discharges have well-established significance, starting from lateralized to generalized to bilateral independent to lateralized and generalized rhythmic delta and sirpids. Sirpids are stimulus-induced periodic discharges. So more or less, you know, in pediatrics, you have established etiology for LPDs, GPDs, and BIPDs. You don't have a lot of literature available on the rhythmic delta activity, and sirpids, very limited information. So what are the etiologies usually? If it's a lateralized, herpes simplex encephalitis is one of the commonest causes, then you can have hemorrhage, you can have toxic metabolic, progressive neurodegenerative disorders, chronic epilepsy, stroke is a common etiology in neonates. If you have generalized discharges, more with status epilepticus and recurrent seizures, prototyping SSP, right? Then you have bipeds, in which you have anoxic, hypoxic, hemorrhage. So more or less, they'll have a lot of overlap, and it is primarily because of the underlying structural correlate. Or if it is a normal MRI brain, then whatever metabolic decompensation in whatever areas it is causing, they will fire, and then it will either cause a lateralized discharge or a generalized discharge or a bilateral independent discharge. So this is an EEG. So can anybody tell me what is happening here? both hemispheres are firing. So what are they? Are they bilaterally independent or they're generalized? Who all thinks that this is generalized? You can at least say yes or no. Don't worry. Who all feels it is not generalized? Okay. Why? Why? How much is the amplitude difference? Both sides is the
time here, left here, right and left. There's a few milliseconds of lag is there.
Are you sure? So again, there may be inter-interpreter variability. I may feel that this is generalized. They may feel this is bilaterally independent. As long as you're able to identify this is a periodic discharge, and then you know the prognostication and what all underlying cause you need to rule out and how you need to treat, it is fine. So if you ask me, I was calling it generalized. But yes, now. So if you see, more or less synchronous, okay, symmetrical, look at here, I mean, look at this one, more or less amplitudes are similar, there is synchronous also, maybe here one hemisphere. So as I said, to call them bilaterally independent or lateralized, it has to be more than 80% of the times this asynchrony has to be there, this predominance has to be there, otherwise it will be more or less generalized, right? Now, I'm just trying to show you that it has persisted for more than 60 seconds, six cycles. Now tell me, are they discharges or they are bursts? So in this periodic discharges and periodic complexes, you may have both components together. You may have some bursts, you may have some discharges. Again, as I said, the underlying etiology, the treatment implication, everything would depend on. It's actually not dependent on the age. There may be bursts, there may be discharges, okay? But you need to identify which are the bursts, which are the discharges for your academic purpose and for reporting. And six cycles has to continue. What has happened now? 30. 6. So this is how it would vary as we come down on the paper speed. What is this now? So we started, there were some periodic discharges, generalized periodic discharges. We could see that some of them were actually bursts, and then we have this continuous discharge. Now, can anybody tell me what is this? Ictal record, okay. We need to see whether there is an artifact or not. Very good. Now we have checked everything. So what is this duration? So can anybody tell me, when do we call it an ictal rhythm? What should be the duration for ictal rhythm?
10 seconds or 25 discharges in 10 seconds.
That is for electrical. That is for electrical seizure. When you call it electrical seizure, it has to either last for 10 seconds, which is more than 2.5 hertz. So 25 discharges in 10 seconds. So this is an ictal rhythm as far as I know. Dr. Prashant, Dr. Goswami, Dr. Saurav can tell me it has to be more than 5 seconds if you have to call it an ictal rhythm. For 10 seconds, you see on EEG, it is an electrical discharge, not an electrical status. When is it called an electrical status? Yes. It either lasts for 10 minutes or 20% of a 60-minute record. So just remember these entities, 5 seconds, 10 seconds, and 10 minutes or 20% in a 60-minute for electrical seizures and electrical status. If it is less than 2.5 hertz, lasting for around 10 seconds, what do you call it? So when it is not fulfilling this electrical seizure criteria, we call it ictal interictal continuum. So I'm just telling you because you may come across these terms when you read, but this is what it is. So more or less, the implications are more or less similar. So in the same EEG, generalized periodic discharges, periodic bursts, and then an electrical seizure. So at this point of time, I'll stop here. This is just a brief on what we can, you know, discuss more in the workshop. We looked at the common clinical findings with genetic generalized epilepsies, common EEG findings, how on the basis of activation procedures we can differentiate between them, what are the common terms used